Hi guys, yes, the last class we have discussed about machine independent code optimization, in which the primary concern is semantic preserving transmissions. Whatever for the benefit of optimization or for improving the speed of the program or for reducing the memory utilization of the program, we are trying this code optimization. That should not alter the logic of the programmer or context of the program, or the functionalities of the program, or functions of the program, altogether any word you can use, that could not be altered. That semantic means the meaning, the context, or the functionality. These all need to be retained. Logic need to be retained. So in within that, we have discussed a global sub-expression elimination or local common sub-expression elimination, copy propagation, decode elimination, constant folding, strength reduction, loop optimization, instruction scheduling, inter-procedural optimization. These two stuff we may need to discuss right now. However, I'll just give you a quick recap. Machine independent optimization technique only we are discussing. What is machine independent? These all anything in the front end compiler design has been converted or can be treated into two different approaches. One is front end and back end. There are guys have written, I don't know how to treat it as. Front end is that web technology terminology they have used. Front end of the compiler design is so and so, back end of the compiler design is so and so. No way related. Front end means it is highly dependent on high level language. So work need to be done on high level language. That means user written programming language need to be done. What is the meaning of in machine dependent or backend is machine architecture or machine code related actions. So in between there is a bridge, intermediate code representation. Intermediate code representation, neither it will be like a machine code nor it will be like a human language. That is where object file .obj, you can notice in your C programming, the moment you do .c program, you can see .obj, .back file and .exe file. So these are all a kind of interrelation I can put forth for your understanding. Anything you write, you will be keeping in the file name .c. That is high level language. That is called front end. Then it will be converted into intermediate code representation. The more or less that I can say intermediate code representation is .obj file, object file. So that is also source code dependent. So anything dependent on source code decision making or transformation, that is called front end. Then what is backend? .exe file. .exe file can be generated only understanding the machine architecture. The .exe file is meant for communicating with the machine, meant for communicating with the CPU, our primary memory, our cache memory, our stack memory, our programming counter registers and flags. Something like that, or processing unit, arithmetic processing unit, multiplication processing unit. There are units available internally. Computer architecture, you would have studied fast multiplication algorithm, floating point operations, those kind of topics you would have studied. These all termed as machine dependent. Towards machine you are started discussing. That is called machine dependent. So anything machine dependent, in the computer's compiler design world, they are telling that backend. Anything source program, user language dependent, in the computer science compiler design, they are terming it as frontend. That's it. So with that notion, let us quickly do the recap. Machine independent and machine dependent technique. You are supposed to work on machine independent technique. Semantic preservation, that is what we discuss. These are all the major 8 techniques given in your syllabus. There are several techniques. So it doesn't mean that only 8 techniques available in the globe. So stipulated syllabus, to have a fair idea to educate you academic purposes, they have brought some glimpse. So that glimpse are those 8 topics. Next, So if you wish this reference, you can use. Even I have used this reference while preparing the material. So Quicksort is the algorithm. It has been taken. Look at here. This is what your high level language, more or less English like language, it will be represented. That will be decomposed into assembly level language or schematic directed translation or three address code representation or quadruple representation. That how it will look, more or less it will look like this. This is the type of format. It will be converted when it comes intermediate code representation. From the intermediate code representation need to be converted into machine code, that is of sixth unit. Shortly we will be addressing in 5-10 minutes. So that is what we discussed. So then from here, always the word you see, local and global, it is very tough. If it is retained as such, the literal transmission of high level language to intermediate, this kind of distinction, what is the distinction, local and global, is very tough. In order to sort out this issue, they are converting the entire intermediate code representation into flow graph. It's a kind of flow graph. The flow of logic happens from the beginning to the end. That's all. Flow graph. Flow chart, you say, no, in your program, you know, same, you can bring the visual representation of the sequence of instructions to be executed or the logic of the instruction to be executed. You can write whatever the way you want, but here there is no special symbols. Only one rectangular. Within that rectangular, initially you need to identify a leader block. Sixth unit, the topic has been given. They would have given here rather than there. The first step is leader block identification. What is leader block? You yourself know what is leader representing. That entire flow graph starts with leader block. The first block of the flow graph can be termed as leader block. That's it in my opinion. So let us forget about that jargons. So in your flow chart, you will be doing start button. Anybody draws the flow chart, no? Start. Then immediately you will be doing any other stuff, something like that. So it's a kind of starting of the logic in the flow graph. It is represented in rectangular. How long the leader block will be continued? Unless otherwise, there is no looping statement. Leader block will be keep on continued. Only the branching will happen. Only two circumstances. Just remember, nothing more. If you see if statement, if you see go to statement, one more, if you see looping statement, then only the branching. For looping also branching will come. See, looping, how it works? The condition is true. Body of the looping statements are executed. If the condition is false, it needs to do something else, no? So that is what they are meant to say, again, one more branch. Loop, if it becomes successful, how the flow is continued. If the loop is unsuccessful, where the flow is transformed. So that, and literally, C language permits go to label. Because of that, you yourself, you the programmer, literally you are using go to. Then that go to also branching happens. Then if, whenever if statement comes, branching happens. One branch, another branch, true or false. These are all the three situations branching will happen. So the moment branching and merging and dividing, joining, this happens means then we need to represent it through flow graph. So that is what we are doing as a flow graph, nothing more. If you have some common understanding of flow chart and some thinking ability, flow chart is not a big challenge at all. See, this is the flow chart. This is flow graph. This is what leader block. First block is a leader block. The second block, see, look at here, go to. This is the looping continuation. If the loop fails, where to go? It's supposed to go to the next loop or next block. These are all the two blocks. Next, this is if. Literally, user tend to give leaf. Then again here there is a branching. If this becomes true, go to B4. See, look at here, B4. If this is true, where is B4? B3, this is what? B4, yeah. Go to B4 if this is true. Go to B6. If this is failure, go to B5. So only one agenda they are keeping it in the rectangular box. You can write go to if less than or equal to J, you can go to B5. Something like that you can write. So after the continuation of B5, again there is a repetition. Go to B2. Then here, hope so you can able to understand. Go to statement, if statement, for statement, wherever it comes, there is a kind of block formation happens. There is a kind of block pointing happens. We need to form the block and we need to point the block. This is part of 6th unit. That's why I'm emphasizing once again a lot. The same only I'll be repeating again there also. The same figure only I will bring there. Or little more different example or analogy I'll be bringing. Next is local common sub-expression or global common sub-expression. So what is sub-expression? You look at 4. A of T6, 4. 2 times 4. is executed. Why that? It is not required. So instead of that, we are replacing all the instances of T7 by T6. The later is replaced by the previous one or prior one. Similarly, if you look at 4J here, 4J here, within the block there is no modification happens. So that the later T10 is replaced by the previous T8. Next is copy propagation. D plus C. This is dependent upon the precedent, the previous statement. So why to compute the later? Later can be copied. That is what copy propagation. Copy to the forward. Suppose if the branch comes via this, this T is copied here. If the branch here, 2 times computation is unavoidable, but if the here, we only one of this computation we are avoiding, we are reducing. That's it. Nothing more we are doing. Next, dead code elimination. Any of the code not reachable, whichever is not required during the compilation itself, identified and removed away. So if you look at I is equal to 1. Now next, global equal to 1. Immediately global equal to 2. What is the meaning? I is not used at all. Suddenly return comes. So that all the three are identified as dead store, not required during the execution time. Our objective is to reduce the cost of execution or cost of CPU or resources only for the execution time, not for compilation time. So that these two can be removed. Next is unreachable. If you look at here global 3, what is the use? The moment the control sees return statement, somewhere the control will be returned back. Why then global equal to 3? There is no purpose, there is no use. So that also can be eliminated during the compilation time. So these are all the things we discussed. Constant folding. During the compilation itself, this can be evaluated. Execution time, we can give this evaluated result because it is constant. No more change will happen. No variable is involved in it. We no need to worry about what would be the value, something like that. So that it can be removed or it can be replaced by EIT, equivalent constant expression value. This is what we discussed. Strength reduction. The cost of multiplication. Here I mean to say cost means not paying in terms of money, rupees, 500 rupees, 1000 rupees, not that cost. The computational complexity. Space complexity, time complexity, computer, these two together is called as computational complexity. That is what cost we mean to say. So the cost of the multiplication is bit higher than cost of addition. Whenever it is possible, the strength need to be reduced. Multiplication need to be replaced by addition, repetitive addition. Exponentiation need to be replaced by repetitive multiplication. If you look at internally, floating point multiplication algorithm or integer. Similarly, exponentiation algorithm internally, that a circuit meant for these two, will be a bit complicated. So the consumption of all the resources, including electricity, I can say it will be more. If you look at here, I into 3 instead of I into 3, it is a constant multiplication. Why can't you try rewriting this terminology in different manner? I into 3, A is equal to T, D is equal to D plus 3, depending upon the context. Not this is true. So look at, they are rearranging. D is equal to 0, then they are rearranging as D is equal to D plus 3. If you are not able to cope up with this image, you can try A is equal to AAA, someone is writing, can be optimized. The strength reduction is A star 3 can be rewritten as A plus A plus A. Next is loop optimization. There is no single concept we have discussed within loop optimization. Frequency reduction. What is the meaning is, the frequency of executing this statement can be reduced because it is always we are using X and X. There is no varying in nature in it. Why can't you move this statement out of this block, prior to this block, compute within the temporary variable or any other variable? So that T need to be inculcated into the repetitive statement. Now the frequency of the looping statement is reduced. Loop unrolling, if it is fixed, we are in the position to print CSE. For this looping statement, if we give, it is costlier affair. Lot of instructions need to be executed. Rather, if we can unroll. So there are 5 times need to be printed. So compilation time itself, we can take decision of, instead of this code, we can compute it into this code. Otherwise, it will come in the form of block loop jamming. So what we can do? The same range, the minimum and the max range is same. Why can't we merge these two components together under one loop is a point of discussion. Next, for the today's topic of discussion, instruction scheduling. For this instruction scheduling, there is no hard and thumb rule. The sequence of instructions need to be arranged. It's a kind of NP complete problem. Hope so, during formal languages you would have studied our analysis of algorithm, what is NP complete and what is NP hard. Finding solution itself, not able to implement practically, theoretically can be discussed. Practically, it is difficult to implement, then it is NP hard. Then what is NP complete? You might be knowing these two. Reordering of the instruction. So, as to keep the pipelines of functional units full with no stalls, no other hurdles should be there when you are rearranging the instruction. It's a compiler optimization problem. This is used in different strategies. One is instruction level parallelism you can do. How you are scheduling instruction is, you can think of instruction level parallelism. But how the algorithm is written in order to do instruction parallelism, when can be done, when cannot be done? That is next question. You have 25 instructions. How this can be computed in parallel manner? Nowadays, lot of computational, high performance computing is working in terms of parallelism and distributed manner. Without these two, nobody can. YouTube cannot do business. Flipkart, Amazon cannot run any business. WhatsApp cannot exist. LinkedIn cannot exist. Facebook, any social media, Instagram, Facebook cannot exist. So parallel execution or parallelism is happening. There it is different concept, but here it is different. So that concept is, I can say, bit easier than this concept. Compilation process need to be parallelized. So that is why it is called NP complete. So next is instruction pipelines. So based on that, you need to give pipelines. What is the meaning pipeline? One after that, one after again, one after one. How need to be executed? So for this, local basic block scheduling. Within the block, you can attempt one method, parallelism. global scheduling across the blocks you can think of, or block level scheduling parallelism, modulo scheduling. What is the meaning is only one instruction you can take, how that instruction you can execute it in parallel manner. Trace scheduling, the next method. Trace scheduling is for controlling the path of the execution, how you can parallelize. Super block scheduling. So these are all some of the scheduling techniques you can think of implementing underneath this instruction scheduling. This itself is a vast topic. So for the understanding point of view, this is more than sufficient. Next, inter-procedural optimization. This is again one of the NP complete problem. Complete may be having function call repeatedly. You may be having function call for the built-in. So within this inter-procedural inter-procedural level, how the optimization can be done? Inter-procedural communication, how need to be optimized? Two functions may be dependent on each other. This function is dependent on computation of that function. That function is dependent on computation of this function. Why can't you think of trying parallelism so that the speed of execution can be increased? So intercommunication may be improved. So these are all the types of attempt can be carried forward with machine independent optimization. Now we are moving on to the next topic of discussion or unit of discussion. Unit 6 is all about code generation. That's all. These are all the topics. Maybe 2 hours more than sufficient to complete from this moment onwards, or 1.5 clock hours sufficient. Now, what is code generation? This is the last phase of compiler. Already knowingly, unknowingly, you would have been familiar with this word, code generation. This is the last phase of the compiler design. So we need to start with what is code generation, what are all the issues associated towards the code generation, what is target language. Target language, otherwise called machine language. Basic blocks and flow graphs. This little bit we have emphasized right now. Simple code generator. What is the way you can generate the code? Next, peephole optimization within the machine dependent type. This is one of the machine dependent type, I can say. Using this, how we can optimize the code? Peephole optimization. It is also related to the optimization technique which we have discussed so far now. Register allocation and assignment. There are limited registers only available. However, the costlier computer you buy also, registers are fixed in nature. Number of registers may be high compared to my machine, GPU processor machine, or you may be having a very costlier machine or high-end processor. That's fine, fantastic. But even you will have limitedness. When you will buy high-end processing, not for doing sum of two number. Definitely you may be interested towards big data, or you may be interested towards deep learning, or you may be interested towards gamification technologies. Something like that only you will be interested for. So when you are interested on those technologies, again the computational complexity is more. The number of data points flowing through the entire execution becomes more. So definitely there also there is a starvation, there is a kind of scheduling is required. If you are buying high performance computing or high end computers, then doing normal exercise, laboratory exercise, sum of two numbers, something, or algorithms, analysis of algorithm, or sorting technique, learning any language, underutilization, then it is not required. Any kind of this topic of discussion not required. When you buy a high end, equivalent to that challenge you will be feeding to your machine, either big data, Hadoop, Spark. So this kind of Scala. So these are all those languages or systems you will be, platforms you will be using, or you will be dealing with big data, or you will go for neural network, or you will go for high computational activities. Only then, or you may do big data with deep learning. Similarly, big data with deep learning in terms of unstructured data also you may be doing. So there also again register scheduling is required. Now also for laptop like you and me, how we are using, that also requires the compiler design level register optimization. Suppose you are listening a music and parallelly you are doing Python programming. Again, for listening to your music also you require register. The piece of frames, there is a kind of decoding, encoding, frame calculation are happening for the video processing also. That also run by a software. Windows Media Player is a software. It's a kind of tool ready to use, but internally it has plenty of coding. Internally it has the mechanism of analog to digital signal conversion, digital to analog signal conversion. Then beyond that, MP4 is what? Compressed video. So again, it is supposed to do decompression. So compression, decompression, that algorithm need to do. So VLC media player, it is not so, it's not a joke. It's a kind of a software. It's a kind of a routine. So that compiler need to work on the process. There also register goes. You may be working on Python. Here also register goes. So parallelly you are doing, especially when you are working with the deep learning, don't play anything, don't work on anything. All the process you need to shut down, only focus on the deep learning machine learning algorithm. Only then you can see something better. Our machine, at least the lifetime of machine will be good. So then the register allocation assignment is a big challenge. Algorithms need to be developed, implemented. That is the reason. We are discussing that in the end. What is register? I said already. Register only can communicate with CPU. See, we are, you and me are citizen. Any one of you can directly go and speak to Prime Minister. Not only the present Prime Minister, any Prime Minister, let it be a humble Prime Minister or the highly economical Prime Minister or citizen friendly Prime Minister or some any kind of Prime Minister. Vajpayee. Prime Minister Vajpayee, he was not having any family. Even then, you cannot go and meet him as you want. Get an appointment. Through them only you can go and talk. Maybe official, their PA or personal secretary or anyone. Directly you and me cannot go and speak to the person. Because costlier affair. The hierarchy, the power of the person is more. Here, the power of the entire computer itself lies with the CPU. CPU efficiency is the prime factor of deciding your cost of the computer. So why we are pricing about CPU? The way in which it deals, the fast, it's all picosecond, nanosecond, microsecond, millisecond, worst case computation. So it will work very rapid, fast. How you can go and communicate? Who can talk to CPU? Who will feed the instruction? Who will feed the data? That is where question mark. CPU need instruction, CPU need data. So who will cope up with that speed? So that is what it is called register. Data is fed to the CPU. Result is taken from CPU by the register. The responsibility of register, it's a kind of collection of flip-flops. It can be 16-bit register, 32-bit register, 64-bit register, 128-bit register. So register is imitated by the circuit of CPU, more or less I can say. The hardware nature, software nature, which is firmware nature, no software when it comes, firmware and hardware nature, which is given to the CPU is extended outside in the form of register. It's a kind of, I can say, miniature of CPU, I can say. So register is the only person can go and throw data, get the data back. Similarly, who can communicate to the CPU to give work? See, suppose one of my relative is coming and giving assignment, will you bother, will you do? Even if I give also, you are not bothering. That is second story. Because you are no way connected. somebody rightly associated person only should give you instruction, command. Who can give command to the CPU is program counter, PC. PC will communicate to CPU to give the work, do this assignment, do this multiplication, do this addition. So all the instructions are fed to the CPU by PC. For the instruction for the work, the necessary data is supplied by registers. These two only powerful enough to communicate with CPU. So that register allocation is important. We should not underutilize registers, or we should not face the problem register insufficiency situation. So in order to do that, we are discussing, this is all of fully related to machine dependent. Hope so you would be understanding what is the importance of register allocation and assignment. Code generation. This is the last phase of the entire compiler design. This is the final phase in the compiler model or compiler design. It takes input from the previous phase called intermediate code generator. So it takes intermediate code representation as an input. So this is what input, intermediate code representation. Next, what else we can discuss? It is optional. Code optimization phase is optional. So it is required, we can't say optional, it is required, but those days books have been written, so they have put like this kind of symbolic representation. I mean to say, we can even write in the modern day, code optimizer is the previous phase of code generator also, nothing wrong in it. That's it. So the exact position of code generator is at the end of the compilation phase or compiler design. So what are all the issues in the design of a code generator? Input to the code generator is one kind of issue. Target program, memory management. Rather than issues, what I can say, this is the syllabus they had given. The responsibilities or roles or components, I can say components, that's all. What are all the work really involved? What are all the actions required? That is what we are discussing. I don't know why they have kept issues. It's not at all issue. So these are, see, what if you say that, if you want to get your Google job, you need to work hard, you need to know this subject, that subject, this many coding, like that I'm trying to tell. You can treat it as issue, or you can treat it as a roadmap, or you can treat it as your responsibility. Choice is yours. So it's like that. So if you are not capable of coping up, then you will say it is an issue that faculty is not at all worth. I am not able to cope up with that person. You will be telling like that. So that is called issue. Then it will become issue for you. If really you are capable and you have thrive for achieving that set goal in your life, then you can say that roadmap. So that's it. So if you look at code generation phase, input, these are all the six: evaluation order, register allocation. Here also they have given register allocation. Once again, exclusive topic also they have given. Instruction selection, memory management, target program, input to code generator, evaluation order. These are all the steps involved in the code generation phase. So what is input to the code generator? Who is communicating with the code generator? Either code optimizer or intermediate. Code optimizer is also not to be discussed too much. There are slight variation we are doing. We'll be removing or we'll be rewriting something slight only. That is not a major challenge at all. The main challenge is with intermediate code generation. Intermediate code generation becomes appropriate, then things will be perfect. If the correct intermediate code transformation happens, only code generation can work perfectly. So where exactly the challenge is available is feeding input, or which form of input we are giving to code generator is the question mark. What type of format we are giving, how we are giving, that is what the big challenge. So if we look at here, these are all the type of code, intermediate code generation possible. So which type of code generation we are giving and how we are communicating the symbol table, because symbol table has data. Please understand, already we discussed symbol table is meant for data. Similarly, register is meant for data. And three address code or intermediate code representation is meant for instruction. Program counter is meant for instructions. So these are all few thumb rules you need to understand, that's all. So these two together, how we are going to feed to the machine, how we are going to communicate to the last phase is the challenge. Again, what is one more challenge is, there are several types of intermediate code generation available. So which one we are choosing? One is linear representation called postfix notation. This has been discussed in your fourth unit. Postfix notation is one of the intermediate code representation. Three address and the quadruple representation. This is one of the intermediate code representation. So three address, quadruple also we have discussed in the fourth unit. Virtual machine representation, stack memory, stack machine code. Just recently, after your all your examination, the very first topic we started with stack memory. So that is called virtual machine representation. There are other techniques involved, that is graphical representation, DAG, directed acyclic graph, and syntax trees. So syntax tree have been discussed. The more or less syntax tree representation only, acyclic, it should not form any kind of cycle, that's all. Directed acyclic, almost is also a kind of tree only, both are interchangeable more or less, I can say. So your form of intermediate code generation can be this. Then intermediate necessary type checking is possible. So type checking, type conversion have been done perfectly. So incompatible, user tend to mix different data types together, because that is what the real life scenario also. You can't all the time work with the same data type. So these are all the challenges. Therefore, input code generation is assumed to be error free. Once if these all, not these all, which one you are going to, suppose you are a compiler designer, already I said some of you or couple of you, if you look at Gudo Wansum, what age he developed this language after his PhD. After the completion of PhD only, he have developed. He is a guy combining blend of both mathematics and computer science. So we don't know, maybe at the age of 40 also, you may come out with some language, at the age of 80 also. There is no stoppage for anybody to invent. You would have heard about the cheapest battery in the world have been invented by one of the professor, the age of 90, retired professor. One more professor is a little bit younger, means maybe 60s or 70s. These two professors together only invented that low cost battery, maybe 3 or 4 years ago. I'm not exactly sure, but long back. I shifted to BVRIT 2 years ago. So not here. I have seen before coming here that particular video, viral video or that article. So there is no scope. So when you are developing a compiler, you need to choose which method of intermediate code generation you are using. Or part of the translation you are using one strategy, part of other translation you are using another strategy. These are up to your caliber, up to your selection or choices. Next is target program. What type of target program? Already we discussed what are all the way input can be given to this machine code. This is input, the inflow, how the inflow coming, outflow, what is the target program? Machine code generation output we are discussing now. We started what is a input to come to that box and how that box need to produce the output. That is the second challenge we are discussing. Underneath, there are three types of things can be performed. One is absolute machine code, another one is relocatable machine code, third one is assembly language. So it can give. Preferably, to my knowledge, most of the textbooks deals, practically I don't know because never I developed a compiler, practically I know, so theoretically, code generation is made easier only by generating assembly code. This is what I understood. So now, but however theoretical perspective, maybe this would have been there initial phase of compiler or partially maybe available till date, I'm not sure. So one is absolute machine code. What is the meaning is, it produces the machine code, it will be stored in the fixed memory location. Immediately executed, can be executed immediately. So this is one strategy. What is another strategy is, you the user or myself, we are writing several sub-programs, functions. Every function will be stored in different memory location. Then it can be combined or referred during the execution. That is called relocatable memory location, memory handling, fixed memory or relocatable machine language. Next is memory management. What is memory management is, names in the source program are mapped to addresses of the data object. Every one of us, we are comfortable in writing name A plus B plus C. We used to write. Finally, that A plus B plus C, only for the user perspective, you want me to understand, not for the machine. Internally, machine can understand if you give some address, go to that 401, go to 405, exactly it need to be informed. So how you will be replacing that names by its addresses? How the translation happens, the routine or mechanism happens? That is what the next stage. Names in the source program are mapped to addresses of the data object in runtime memory by the front end and core generator. That's it. Finally, name how you are converting it into address. Similarly, it makes use of symbol table. Name in the three address statement refers symbol table entry. Here, names, first step we are discussing that address of data object. Second step we are bringing where that address of objects are available. That's all. Little bit detail. You can merge these two points and you can write in one way. One is all the names in the source program are stored as a symbol or label into the symbol table entry. Then the corresponding address of the data object need to be referred. That is another challenge. Labels in the three address statement have to be converted into address. That's all. Whatever label, constant name, you put in this way also in your examination point of view. All the names, symbolic names, constant names, function name, whatever stored in the symbol table, that all, symbol table definition you are writing, that all you need to write here. Those all need to be replaced by address, not by anything else. So that is called the next challenge, memory management. Look at here, J, go to I. If I less than J, quadruple is generated, I greater than J. So whenever you look at I, J, everything need to be replaced by its symbolic name or its symbolic addresses. So with that note, let me stop at this point now. Maybe third hour we'll be having once again. Third hour, Anjan sir today asked me to handle, so I accepted. Since 1 hour I handed over to Anjan sir, so I'm accepting and I'll be handling.